Remember the time-traveling DeLorean from the 1985 film series Back to the Future? And how Doc, the disheveled inventor-scientist with Einsteinian hair, powered his time-traveling DeLorean with banana peels and pizza? While time travel and flying cars remain a figment of human imagination, waste-fueled flights are on aviation's not-too-distant horizon. Fasten your seatbelts, because in this video, we're flying high into blue skies to see how the aviation industry is changing its energy itinerary by going green with new waste-based fuels called Sustainable Aviation Fuels, or SAF, that can directly substitute for existing jet fuel without the CO2 emissions. We'll look at the state of emissions from the aviation industry today and why it's so challenging to eliminate its climate impacts. We'll also learn about SAF, what it is, and how it's made. And we'll dig into some SAF data to unearth adoption trends and see what it will take to scale SAF towards net zero aviation and how you can get in on the action yourself today. I'm Rosie Barnes, founder of Padlo Consulting, where we advise on clean energy technologies, helping startups with development and investors with assessing the landscape. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Let's start with a look at how the aviation industry works today and the energy problems it faces. Did you know that aviation accounts for 2.5% of global CO2 emissions? Did you maybe think it would be more than that? This number may seem small, considering how much it's talked about, compared with some of the climate's bigger offenders like agriculture, industry, and road transport. However, while the CO2 contribution may be quite small, aviation's contribution to global warming is nearly double that number, at 4%. That's due to other warming effects from aviation, such as the concentration of other atmospheric gases and pollutants produced by planes, which, when released at high altitudes, contribute much more to warming than the same emissions on the ground. To examine why that is, let's compare emissions from ships on the Earth's surface versus similar emissions from aeroplanes up high. Ships, like planes, emit aerosols, tiny sulfur or carbon particles that can change clouds. Because ships release these emissions lower in the atmosphere, the affected clouds are nearer to the Earth's surface. Clouds closer to Earth's surface tend to be thicker and brighter. They also tend to stay, well, grounded, and the carbon dioxide emitted is more likely to be absorbed by CO2 sinks like the ocean, plants, dirt, and microbes found in soil. And because clouds close to the ground are thick and bright, they reflect incoming sunlight back into space, creating an overall cooling effect. Clouds higher in the atmosphere, on the other hand, tend to be thinner and allow sunlight to easily pass through them while absorbing and re-radiating infrared heat back down to Earth's surface. Plane emissions affect atmospheric gases and pollutants like water vapor, sulfur aerosols, NOx, methane, ozone, and contrails. While some of these can cool, the overall impact is warming. In fact, CO2 emissions from jet fuel account for less than half of aviation's warming impact on Earth. Two-thirds come from non-CO2 factors, with contrails claiming the largest share. A contrail, or condensation trail, is the water vapor produced from an aircraft's exhaust. It's an artificial cloud that forms when water vapor from burning jet fuel condenses and freezes when it contacts cold air. Artificial clouds streaking across the sky may look harmless, kind of like a fluffy sky scarf. However, like naturally produced clouds, and like winter scarves, they trap heat and keep it from leaving the Earth's atmosphere. Adding clouds in the form of contrails results in an overall increase in the amount of energy that stays Earthside of the cloud. Now that we have a better understanding of aviation's non-CO2 emissions and how they contribute to climate change, let's talk about aviation's other big problem, burning jet fuel. From 40 years ago, and still to this day, the main fuel used in aviation is jet fuel, a refined kerosene-based fuel which emits CO2 when it's burned. Emissions from aviation rose steadily from the start of commercial flight to today, with a short blip during COVID. This is because demand for passenger and freight flights roughly quadrupled between 1990 and 2019. However, efficiency has doubled over the same period, meaning that the overall emissions intensity has only doubled. Now that we've looked at the current state of emissions in aviation, let's try to understand why decarbonizing aviation is difficult and how SAF offers the fastest route to success. Ever heard the saying rebuilding the plane while flying? It's a business metaphor for a high-stakes situation where the existing systems or infrastructure must stay fully operational while a difficult transformation occurs. It's a decent metaphor for the energy transition, actually. Commercial planes last an average of 20 to 30 years and can fly anywhere between 60 to 75,000 flight cycles. The existing fleet of commercial planes is about 15 years old, which means a significant portion of our existing commercial planes still have half of their flying lives left. If we're going to decarbonize aviation for long-haul flights quickly, we need to replace jet fuel with a fuel that works with existing jet engines. Otherwise, airplane manufacturers will literally have to rebuild their planes and many other supporting infrastructures that make flight possible. While some promising technologies for decarbonizing aviation are in the works, such as hydrogen and electricity, those solutions are really challenging slash impossible to make work for long-haul flights. They require significant R&D investments in new aircraft design and certification, along with potentially insurmountable logistical issues related to charging or fueling. And progress has not been as fast as we were promised just a few years ago. Airbus, for example, had plans to build hydrogen-powered commercial aircraft by 2035, but has now pushed their target date out by at least 5 to 10 years. This is where SAF takes center stage. The quickest and safest route to decarbonizing aviation is to make a fuel that's identical to jet fuel, so it can directly replace fossil fuels in the existing fleet of commercial planes. Let's take a deeper look at SAF, how it's made, and who some of the pioneers of the industry are. A sustainable aviation fuel is a biofuel, that's a fuel made from renewable biomass, often derived from natural waste or garbage. To qualify as SAF, fuels need to be drop-in compatible with existing jet engines and fuel infrastructure, and achieve a significant life cycle emissions reduction compared to conventional jet fuel. SAF can also refer to e-fuels, aka powered liquid, where green hydrogen and captured CO2 are turned into liquid hydrocarbon fuels. But the cost-effectiveness of those seems iffy even in the long term. Imagine turning your leftover pizza and banana peels into jet fuel. That's the magic of SAF. While we're not usually taking pizza and banana peels specifically, SAF can be created from a variety of feedstocks, usually renewable biomasses such as grains, algae, and greases, as well as agricultural and forestry residues. They can also be made from wet and solid municipal waste streams or poo. If poo-powered airplanes aren't your thing, that's okay. Various physical, biological, and chemical reactions in SAF production can break down other feedstocks and recombine them into energy rich hydrocarbons. There are four ways to produce SAF that have been already approved by international standards organizations, but one has risen to the top of the emerging market to maturity. The HEFA process, which stands for Hydroprocessed Esters and Fatty Acids, uses oils and fats to generate hydrocarbons for SAF production. It can use waste and used cooking oil, animal fats, and veggie oils from, say, soy and corn. Of all four approved SAF methods, this one is most ready for prime time, largely because it's well understood. It also has much greater yields with little waste. 50% of the yield becomes a SAF, and the rest can be converted into biodiesel for road transportation. While HEFA can currently be blended with jet fuel up to 50%, HEFA SAFs do not provide a perfect solution and present some problems of scale. As demand for SAF has increased, the demand for HEFA feedstocks, primarily cooking oil and animal fats, has increased rapidly, but supply from these waste streams can't be easily increased, so costs have risen. Other current agricultural sources are also going to be hard to scale to match the expected increase in demand for long-haul flights. But perhaps there are ways to get around this. Energy companies like BP are investing in alternative high energy crops to be approved for HEFA production. A few of these new crops include algae, camelina or wild flax, pennycress, tallow tree, and carinata, a type of rapeseed. Carinata can be used as a cover crop, which is exciting because a cover crop protects and enriches the soil without increasing land demand, lending itself to sustainable farming practices. In addition to the HEFA process, there are three other processes approved. These are one, synthesized ISO-parrafins or SIPs, which use sugarcane or sugar beet feedstocks, but can only be blended up to 10%. Two, ethanol or alcohol to jet fuels, and three, Fisher Tropsch SAFs, both of which can achieve higher emissions reductions than the others, but their maturity is currently lower. There are projects underway to commercialize each of these and come up with new methods to produce SAF. One of the most exciting I've found is the work being done by Pacific Northwest National Laboratory in partnership with their industrial partner, LanzaTech. This team has produced a new ethanol to jet SAF by capturing carbon monoxide produced during steel production. Instead of allowing it to escape into the air, it's fed to hungry microbes that consume it, then produce ethanol as their waste product. Through this unique research to industry partnership, PNNL and LanzaTech have successfully successfully shown that they can produce their ethanol-based SAF at commercial scale. Their fuel has also been approved by ASTM International for commercial use and has undergone multiple flight tests with daring early adopters such as Virgin. In addition to these accomplishments, test flights using this unique ethanol-to-jet SAF produced 95% less soot and contrails than a petroleum jet fueled flight. That's a two-in-one solution for reducing carbon emissions and addressing the non-CO2 contrail conundrum I mentioned earlier. To understand where the world is on its path toward adopting SAFs, let's look at what the production data says. The good news is that the volume of sustainable aviation fuel produced in 2022 was roughly double that produced in 2021. The not so good news? The amount of sustainable aviation fuel produced in 2022 was only, drumroll, 0.1% of the total of jet fuel production. The ugly news? Sustainable aviation fuel costs at least twice the cost of traditional jet fuels. While this isn't great, it is expected. As SAF production scales, feedstock options will become more diverse and SAF technologies and operations will mature. That should mean that prices will drop. Like all new technologies, new SAF solutions are costly, but tend to become more cost-effective over time. Though I have to note that SAF prices will likely never be cheaper than jet fuel. So if we want to reduce emissions from aviation, there has to be a non-economic reason to do it. Time is of the essence. The International Air Transport Association has a net zero plan for 2050 that includes 65% adoption of SAF. A critical milestone will be the ramp up to 5.2% SAF production, or 23 billion litres of SAF, produced in the year 2030. That's a 76 times increase in just 8 years from 2022. 65% SAF usage in 2050 will result in about 53% CO2 emissions reduction overall, with the additional reduction gap expected to come from technology improvements, hydrogen, operations and infrastructure improvements, and market measures like offset programs and incentives. To make SAF and our garbage-fueled flying dreams come true, we need to invest more in technology, scale up, and governments' operations. Scaling SAF production from sustainable sources includes deciding what biomass sources to invest in and where to develop them. But how do we scale up SAF production without affecting our food supply? That's a question that needs to be answered. Airports also need an upgrade to handle SAF transportation. Right now, SAFs are mixed with traditional jet fuels, but the goal is to use 100% sustainable aviation fuel eventually. Airlines, manufacturers, and regulators are all working together to make this happen. Currently, there aren't many SAF production facilities compared to petro counterparts. This means SAFs often travel longer distances or take more complicated routes to get to mixing facilities. But some airports have started partnering with SAF producers to bring production closer to airports, making transport easier. Now, I'm a person who cares a lot about the climate impact of my actions, but I also fly a lot. Not in a flying DeLorean, unfortunately, but also not in a private jet that I can choose to fuel with SAF. But what I can do is choose to fly with early adopter airlines. United Airlines purchased more SAF than any other airline since 2013. They are also actively participating in the push to increase the role SAF can play in the future. They flew the first passenger flight using 100% SAF in one engine. And while Delta Airlines may have over-egged the net zero-ness of their operations a few years back, they seem to be doing a better job of directly reducing their emissions now, and they blended 3.5 million gallons of SAF into their fuel supply in 2023 alone. Air France, KLM, Lufthansa, and American Airlines all use some amount of SAF too. And if you can't or don't want to use those airlines, there is still a possibility to donate to specific airline SAF programs or pay a premium for SAF blended flights from wherever you are using programs like AV Fuels SAF Wherever You Fly. I myself am now favoring those methods over buying traditional offsets like I used to, because traditional offsets tend to be basically garbage. But prepare yourself for sticker shock. I am jumping in to share my experience when I went to actually put my money where my mouth is and buy SAF for an upcoming flight I'm taking. So 100% carbon offsets, 31 euros. 100% sustainable aviation fuel, 1373 euros. So even if you can't afford to pay for the SAF for your flight, I think it's definitely still worth doing this exercise because it highlights what is the difference that we actually have to make to the aviation industry. And you can't have this like false sense of security of having bought offsets. I have always known that offsets don't really do anything. Paying someone to not cut down a tree, which is meaningless, versus the cost of actually decarbonizing aviation, which at the end of the day is what we need to do. I do have a full video on precisely that topic, exactly how much garbage they are coming up in the next video or two, so stay tuned for that. In Back to the Future 3, Doc travels back to 1885. It was just a couple of decades after Edwin Drake drilled the first commercially successful oil well in Titusville, Pennsylvania. Suppose you could travel back to that moment. Would you warn Edward Drake of the massive problem he unknowingly created for future generations by opening the black box of modern-day petroleum extraction? Knowing what you know now, what would you hope to change? Well, we can't change the past, but we can always look to the future to change our flight trajectory, metaphorically and literally. This video has been about SAF, the safest bet for turning our blue skies green for long-haul flying. But we've only scratched the surface of the possibilities for making aviation more sustainable. Additional solutions are taking off for tackling contrail clouds and new fleets of greener, more sustainable aeroplanes that use hydrogen batteries and fuel cells for electric propeller propulsion systems. We'll cover some of those in future videos. Until then, as Doc so aptly proclaimed, the future is what we make it. So let's make it sustainable. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team for supporting this and all the videos on this channel. We also have an exclusive Discord server where we discuss energy news, technologies, and our own energy-related projects. We'd love to welcome you to the team. You can join at this link. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.